How y'all doing? Good? Who's ready to praise the Lord? Whoop, whoop. All right. Hey, let's stand on our feet for the announcements. We're just going to start warming up. We're going to do some jogging in place. Or we can just have two announcements. We'll go with the announcements. First of all, first two Sundays in March, we're going to be doing our new member class. It's going to be Sunday afternoons from about 2 to 4. We're going to hang out and talk about what does it mean to follow Jesus from a Lutheran perspective, and what is Trinity doing here in the Valley? What are we trying to do for the good of our neighbors? So that's the 3rd and the 10th of March from 2 to 4 p.m. You can register in the app or at churchcenter.trinitycalispell.org. And then I thought we'd take a quick second and pray for our auction. Our auction is a huge blessing to our school and all the ministry therein, so please pray with me. Gracious Heavenly Father, we commend to your care, to your blessing, all of those who are striving to make this year's auction a success. Lord, we thank you for all those who have participated in this preparation, whether through purchasing raffle tickets or making gifts or sponsoring the event. Lord, as in all that we do, may this auction glorify your holy name. May it empower us to make an impact for Jesus in our community. All this we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's praise his name.
Remember those walls that we call sin and shame. They were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are rubble now. Remember those giants we call death and grave. They were like mountains that stood in our way. But he came and he died and he rose. Those giants are dead now. This is our God. This is who he is. He loves us. This is our God. This is what he does. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim, this is our God, King Jesus. Remember that fear that took our breath away. Faith so weak that we could barely pray. But he heard every word, every whisper. Now those altars in the wilderness tell the story of his faithfulness. Never once did he fail, and he never will.
So Jesus, as he's preparing to ascend, he's with his disciples, and as he leaves, he sends them and he commands them with great power. In fact, he says, all authority in heaven and on earth belongs to me. And then he sends them, go, as you go, to disciple all nations. But he sends them in his power and with his authority. He promises them that they will do the things that he has done and that the church will grow and prosper in the proclamation of what the cross of Christ has done and won for them. So as we begin this morning, we do so in the power and authority of his name, the glory of his kingdom. Friends, we begin in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Join me as together we confess our need. Almighty God, you are the loving Father who seeks us out every day. We confess we have been selfish with the things you have given us. We confess that we have not been compassionate to our neighbors. Forgive us for running away from you and your will for our lives. You are always calling us back with your unfailing love. Connect us again through Jesus' love poured out for us upon the cross. And by your Holy Spirit, work through us to show our neighbors who you really are, that we may share with them the grace of our God. Friends, in order for you to share the grace of God, you have to receive it. And God promises that his authority will uphold you, not with divine commands or demands or even threats, but uphold you with divine grace and compassion. And when the grace of God upholds you, when he sustains you with his power, it feels like this. Your sins, all of your sins, every single last one of your sins, they are forgiven. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's share that love of Jesus with those around us. I learned it.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Through the sun. There's a place for me. child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
You may be seated as we continue with our scripture readings.
Today's reading comes from Ephesians, starting chapter 5, verses 15. Look carefully, then, how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart. Giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, and that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might be present, the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are all are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, and this is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and that you may live long in the land. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Bondservants, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, with a sincere heart, as you would Christ. Not by the way of eye service as people pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, rendering service with a good will as to the Lord and not to man, knowing that whatever good anyone does, this he will receive back from the Lord, whether he is a bondservant or is free. Masters, do the same to them and stop your threatening, knowing that he who is both their masters and yours is in heaven, and that there is no partiality with him. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the Holy Gospel as you're able.
We turn to the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 20th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came up to him with her sons, and kneeling before him, she asked him for something. And he said to her, "What do you want?" She said to him, "Say that these two sons of mine are to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left in your kingdom." Jesus answered, "You do not know what you are asking for. Are you able to drink the cup that I am to drink?" They said to him, "We are able." He said to them, "You will drink my cup, but to sit at my right hand and at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father." And when the 10 heard it, they were indignant at the two brothers. But Jesus called them and said to him, "To him and said, You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be your slave. Even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. This is the gospel of the Lord. Grace unto you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Believe it or not, we're in week 5 of our message series for this very purpose. Paul's writing to a church that he planted in Ephesus. And he spent a long time there, almost 3 years. He poured into them his message, and he's writing this letter to remind them what he has spoken to them. As we prepare to go into this section of the letter, I want to reiterate Jesus' words, for this whole teaching is on authority. Whose authority do we have? What authority do we have? How do we live out authority? And Jesus, as he talks about this, he's fairly straightforward. He says, you know that the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Just as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Brecken, can you turn my mic down just a little bit? Thank you. For this very purpose, we've been walking through this letter, and we've seen some very clear opportunities as Paul is teaching them what is this very purpose he's talking about. And God's purpose is clear. Chapter 1, the same purpose for the Father, same purpose for the Son, same purpose for the Holy Spirit. All three members of the Trinity united in purpose, the purpose of lovingly bringing you back to himself. If you are a confirmation student, write that down. It's the purpose of the letter. It's for this very purpose he writes everything else. God has unilaterally decided that he's going to work for this purpose, and he's going to empower his church to work for this very purpose, to talk about this very purpose, to live this very purpose. And there's something important about the way that God's going to do this. He does it relationally. He does it through creating relationships and connecting people with each other. As Paul gets to chapter 5 of his letter, we're reminded that every relationship has power involved. Who's in charge? Who gets to make the call? Who's making the decisions? And for crying out loud, who is going to decide where we go to eat for dinner? It's hard. It's like the number one problem in today's society. Amen? Yeah, right. Where are we going to eat dinner at? So, let's see what's going on here. Chapter 2, he wants to ground everything in a very simple reality. It's not super complicated. It's not overly complex. It's really quite simple. You have been saved by grace through faith. You've been saved by grace. There's no need for you to earn anything. In fact, you cannot, and even if you could, you would not. So he has saved you by grace. He has authored and penned your salvation with his own blood. You are free in Christ from all that would accuse you of wrong. And he sets you free to be his masterpiece. His masterpiece that he creates in you by the power of the Holy Spirit for good, for his good, for his good works. This is what God has done. And as he pulls all of us together, no matter where we're coming from, no matter what lineage we have, he's called us together in peace. The rest of the sermon, I'll go a little slower. Are you doing all right?
Yeah.
All right, sweet. I'll go fast. All right. So as God executes his plan for salvation, as he calls us to follow him and to live out this same purpose and communicate the mystery of his grace, he has some very important instruction. So last week we hit on this slide. We actually used this exact slide to label some big, broad ways he's telling us, this is how I want the church to be. I want the church to be engaged with the guides, whether you're following Paul, or whether you have Pastor Timothy, whether you have Pastor Peter, whether you have Pastor Brian, to engage your pastor, to be involved, to be gleaning from them the scriptures. And then part two is to get out of your own way. Gideon illustrated us this for us. Get out of your own way. That old sinful self is clinging to you. The selfish ambitions, the power-hungry version of you keeps coming out and getting in our way. So Paul calls us to get out of our own way, to leave that old sinful self behind. And then lastly, you only have one leader. His name is Jesus. And he wants you to follow him so close that the dust of his sandals is constantly in your eyes, covering your face, covering you head to toe. This week, we started our reading where we left off last week. This is one of those sections. It's almost in every single letter that Paul has written, where he spends about 3-4 paragraphs encouraging us to literally walk in a worthy manner. He uses this exact phrase in Philippians and Colossians. He uses it in the book of Ephesians, which we are in, and he uses it in his letters to the Corinthians, to walk in a manner worthy. And then he continues and describes this, but he's using big, broad categories to bear with one another, okay? To have this forgiveness among you and among your families. And he continues to encourage us in other rather vague but really important things that we need to be maturing. He doesn't give specific instructions, but that we should all be growing in our maturity into the fullness of faith. And then he uses big statements like this. Every single one of us would say, being an imitator of God, awesome. How do you do it Tuesday afternoon? Well, there's a few more questions. As he gets further along in this section, he gets a little more specific. Speak truth. Don't steal. Don't slander. No crude joking. Right? So he's getting rather specific, encouraging us, how do we walk in a manner worthy? How do we live out the fact we've been called by grace and saved by grace and destined for grace? Okay, so it's all these things. But what he focuses on is concrete ways to connect with others. And this is where Ephesians has a whole lot of very important news for you. Jesus is all about people. He's all about people. He's all about caring for people. He's about meeting people where they're at. He's about speaking good news to the broken. He's about seeking out the lost, even if it's the one that's lost. His compassion and passion to connect with people leads him to the cross. God believes your life is best when it's connected with Jesus. What he's going to give us now is three relationships where we get to live out the grace that he has for us. So, we already said that enough. It begins with this section. This is like his big intro statement. Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. So he's going to call them to live differently. And at this point, it's really important that you hear echoes of Jesus' words, right? Imagine it, right? Two of the disciples come with their mommy to Jesus, right? And mommy, you can imagine, right? Pushing them on their backs. Come on, boys. Right? Walks up to Jesus and is like essentially saying, I've got your two best disciples here. And I think you should give them power. Jesus takes that traditional power pyramid and flips it all the way on its head. And you can tell it's not just on two of the 12's mind, it's on all of their minds, it's on all of their hearts, all 12 of the disciples, hoping beyond hope that they're going to be the ones that are put in charge, they're going to be the ones that get to have power and authority, all while trying to act super humble. Maybe you know what this is like. And Jesus calls them to be slaves. He calls them to be servants. But he doesn't give them that call because he thinks it's good for them. He gives them that call because he knows that it's good for them, because it's what he is doing for them. We're going to look at three different categories, three different relationships. And these three different relationships, we're going to look at from the perspective that the key operating relationship is between that person and Jesus. And when that relationship with Jesus is in Jesus' name, called to serve other people, it changes it. It changes it. But we must remain understanding that the key operative relationship is between us and Jesus. I threw this picture up there for you to visualize. Every single one of us, we have differing relationships. I'll go out on a limb here and I'll ask Aaron. Aaron, who do you see the most? Your wife? Okay. I'm glad you answered that way, because it would have been awkward if you said somebody else. So his very inner circle consists of one person. His most intimate relationship is with his wife and none other. That's just him. And who else do you see a lot? Your kids, good. You passed both tests. All right, flying colors. And so his next line is his kids, and then probably coworkers and neighbors and extended family and building on there out, but all in their different layers. Now, in your life, you probably work with other men, other women, and those people are probably married to others. And so what we have here in our life is a bunch of different circles all radiating out from us as individuals. We have all these different layers of relationship, different places where we are connecting with other people. And Jesus desires that we connect with them and we connect them with him. Many times these layers overlap. We have differing relationships with all people. So Paul's going to teach us now, how do we live out these relationships using the power paradigm of Jesus that we're called to serve? So we're going to see his power at work in our lives. We're going to start with marriage. Well, wait, everyone's good at that, right? We can move on. All right. Marriage, super easy relationship. Long ago, we mastered it. So, we didn't. So he starts there. He starts the very inner circle, and he uses the lovely S word. Submit. Wives, submit to your own husbands. Because they're smart, good-looking, super talented, they always know what's best, and they never make mistakes. That's in the elongated version. Don't worry. Husbands are next, women. It's going to be great. So he starts right here, and he said, but look at the operative relationship as to the Lord. Little warning, that might be the theme here. Let's go to number two. Husbands, love your wives because they're beautiful. They always have everything done to your liking. They follow your preferences. They pick out your clothes every Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday and make you look great. Right? No, it says, husbands, love your wives. Right? Love them as Christ loves the church and gave himself up for her. So the operative paradigm, the number one relationship on both ends of the marriage spectrum is Jesus. Is his call how we should answer our call? So marriage was easy. Two easy steps. There you go. Family. How's family supposed to work? Children, obey your parents in the Lord. Again, the operative relationship is your child's relationship with Jesus. Right, Noah? Yeah, he gets it. So from the children's perspective, they're doing it in the Lord. How about the parents? Well, he picks on dads a little bit, but he says, dads, do not provoke your children to anger. Bring them up in the instruction of the Lord. Again, parents, the operative relationship, the connection that is determining all other connections is your connection with Jesus, his call on your life. So dads, that means if you really want your kids to play basketball, but they'd rather play croquet, Jesus didn't choose. Bless them in their croquet career. All right? So we don't get to put our preferences on them. It's all about in the Lord, of the Lord. It's that operational relationship. Now, I label this next section society. As we look at this section of God's Word, some of it is so cross-cultural for us. We practically lack the ability to fully understand it. A key part of their society when Paul is there is that there would be bondservants. We don't understand this. One thing we do know is that it's far and away from the idea of slavery that we knew here in the States. It was a part of how their society worked. But what we do know is even there in that relationship, the closest answer that you would probably have in your own life is with your boss, is with the person who you're directly accountable to professionally. And he has the same words for them, even in the workplace. Bondservants, obey your earthly masters as you would Christ. The operative relationship is Jesus. On the exact opposite side, masters, render service with a good will, knowing he who is your master in heaven. So whether you're husband or wife, child or parent, employee, employer, master, servant, no matter what relationship you have, Paul sets up the whole Christian life to be relationally driven discipleship, where the primary relationship is between us and Jesus. He pulls it all together once again by communicating the very clear reality that it's going to be different among my people, that my kingdom is not going to be a kingdom where might makes right, the survival of the fittest, and that the biggest, strongest ones get everything. Because my kingdom will be built on the cross. My kingdom will be built here by servants. My kingdom will be built on sacrifice. Friends, it is the sacrifice of Christ that has called you out of the darkness and into his light. It's called you from a life of self-righteousness to a life of his righteousness. It is the sacrifice of Christ that he desires to live on through you, that you would see your relationships, all of your relationships, as primarily flowing from his sacrifice, so you may proclaim his riches to your kids at work, and even in your marriage. Friends, It's for this purpose that he has called you. He's called you and made you to be his masterpieces. Created by Christ Jesus, you are exactly that, his masterpiece. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, our lives are full of relationships. We have many layers of relations, and we have those who come into our lives and those who come out of our lives, Lord, but you would lead us not to lives that are power hungry and to control others, but lives that revolve around your cross, the call to be your disciples, lives where we are willing to submit so that the sacrifice of Christ may live on, may live through us. Jesus, we pray that you would lead us in this life for your glory. All this we pray in your most holy and sacred name. Amen. Friends, as we are able, we rise. Let's join together in speaking the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, he descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we take time to worship God with our tithes and offerings.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations.
My God, I need you now.
your faithfulness.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you know that of our own devices, we remain selfish. We know the good that we ought to do, and so often, Lord, we do not do it, instead doing the very thing we do not want to do. Lord, our pursuit of power is one of those things. We pray, Lord, that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would lead us, that you would lead us in the same sacrificial life that you led Jesus, that you lead us to submit out of reverence to you and to see others as more significant than ourselves, to lift them up, Lord, and to love them. First and foremost, all of this stems from our relationship with you. Heavenly Father, it is only by your Holy Spirit that any of us can count others more significant than ourselves. It's only by the power of your Holy Spirit that we will be your church. Bless us in this, Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Gracious Heavenly Father, it's a gift to come to you in prayer. And so we name before you those who are sick and suffering, especially Janice, Nancy, Andrew, Randy, Dave, Arlene, Lorraine, Bruce, and Claudia. We also pray for those who are suffering as they grieve the loss of a loved one. We pray for the families of Frank, Doris, Henry, Ben, and Barbara. Lord, be their strength and their refuge. Be their ever-present help in all their times of need. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who are serving our country. This service often calls them from their home and from their families. So we ask, Lord, that you would preserve and protect Tucker and Jaden, James, Cole, Wyatt, John, Eli, Preston, Garrett, Dylan, Tavian, Cole, Mark, Chris, Reed, and Jared. Lord, as they serve our country, it's also right that we pray for the secular leaders that you have allowed into positions of leadership. So we pray for President Biden, and we pray for all of our national leadership. We pray for those leaders you have appointed at our state and local levels also. Lord, preserve them and lead them in all righteousness. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Heavenly Father, your church continues to grow. Your grace continues to impact those who are being crushed by the weight of the law. Lord, this afternoon, baby Camden is going to become your daughter in the waters of holy baptism. We pray that you would strengthen her continually by your Spirit. Lead her, Lord, to show this world the grace that is hers. And Lord, we also thank you that this morning you will call us to your table, where here you will give to us the fruit of your cross, the body and the blood of Jesus. Lord, we rejoice with Tom and Helena, who are joining us for the first time. Lord, bless them by this gift unto life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Gracious Heavenly Father, you have given us all the gifts necessary for life and salvation. And so it's right then that we should pray as Jesus has commanded, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Amen. Friends, as we come forward to receive the gifts and Holy Communion, it's right that we should ponder anew the mystery that Jesus would pour out himself so willingly unto us. So we see the first two questions here state clearly that... Next slide. That this meal is for the baptized children of God, a meal given to uphold them in all their times of need. And it's also a gift of a meal where we hear that Jesus has tied himself directly to the bread and the wine that we would receive his body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins. And then on this next slide, you'll see we desire from this gift of Holy Communion that our lives would reflect the love of Jesus, and that we intend by the power of the Holy Spirit to love our neighbors. It's this call that God renders unto us as he draws near to you yet again. Friends, all of this comes from his last night with his disciples. And as he sat with them, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples. As he did so, he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." Then in the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and drink. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. You may be seated.
Great is your faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. You never change your compassions, they fail not. As you have been, you forever will be. Great is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, your hands have provided. Great is your faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature and manifold witness to your great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, your hands have provided. Great is your faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that's enduring, your own dear presence to cheer and to guide. strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is your faithfulness, great is your faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, your hands have provided. Great is your faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is your faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember, redemption's here, your blood was spilled. My ransom, everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me, lead me to the cross. You were as I, tempted and tried. I need you. soften my heart, break me apart. I need you to open my eyes, see that you're shaping my life. All I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good, and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I need you. Dark and cleanse every part of me. All I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. Your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I need you to soften my heart, break me apart. I need you. Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Through the sunset's free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Always free indeed. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me. There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
We'll turn once again to the blessing that Paul gives to the church in Ephesus, to your brothers and your sisters who are in Christ Jesus. And it goes like this: now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. We join together in our final song.
I would be hopeless without your goodness. I would be desperate without your love. Slave to the darkness, if it wasn't for the cross. You have won me with your kindness. Chase me down when I was lost. For the cross. Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not.
Go in peace and praise the Lord. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. Alleluia.
By your stripes I'm